Okay, so I'll just give the countdown. We are live in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Good morning, everyone. We welcome you all to Ortho TV and IOA TV in association with Indian Orthopedic Association. To introduce today's topic and the speakers, I hand over to Dr. Dinesh Thakkar to take over the meeting.
Good morning, everybody. Thanks for the cooperation from Ortho TV and IOA TV. I am very much thankful to Dr. Shiv Shankar, our president, because he is very much interested in all these activities and supported like anything, including the organizing the meeting and even to reach up to the members that this meeting is being organized. So he is helping in spreading the schedule to all orthopedic surgeons. Today we have a very interesting talk. Usually, as we all know, that is a bit neglected by orthopedic fraternity. Probably there are so many reasons. It is my little effort to throw a light on which this is not being much discussed at most of the in this current scenario. So I have invited all devoted persons, those who are very much interested to preserve the original knee, God-given knee. So all three speakers are very much devoted, and they believe, and it's a right that we have to preserve our own God-given knee. First, I will introduce the speakers. First, Dr. Sanjay Rastogi. He is very much interested in open wedge high tibial osteotomy. He has done fellowship with Dr. Stobley at Luzern. And after that, he is regularly performing high tibial osteotomy by open wedge and fixed with Tomopix. He will teach us in detail how we can perform and in such a way that any orthopedic surgeon who wants to do it first time, then also he may not find any difficulties while performing the surgery. And after that, more popularized surgery by Dr. Mangal Pariyar. And most of the orthopedic surgeons are doing, probably other orthopedic surgeons, those who are doing high tibial osteotomies are mostly by external fixators. Gradual medial opening is very popular all across the India. So after that, Sanjay Rastogi, Dr. Mangal Parihar, who is performing gradual medial open wedge with external fixator and teaching all the youngsters. And most of the youngsters find it very easy by external fixator, and he will teach our new upcoming orthopedic surgeons that how we can perform very easy way to do high tibial osteotomy. Even our president, Dr. Shiv Shankar, has done gradual medial opening wedge after seeing and learning from Dr. Mangal Pariyar, and he find it very easy. So after that, Mangal Parihar will teach us gradual medial open wedge high tibial osteotomy. And after that, there are some limitations in open wedge high tibial osteotomies. And obviously, none of the surgery is out of complications. So after that, Dr. Milind Chaudhary, everybody knows he is from Akola, and he is also a very devoted person to preserve the original knee. And he has organized a national conference in 2010, April 2010. By calling Professor Koshino, and it was very much supported by all members of the Orthopedic Society. So he will discuss about the complications and limitations of open wedge high tibial osteotomy. So these are the various talks, and we have a very devoted person for high tibial osteotomy, Dr. Kishore Maheshwari, as a panelist. He will give his own inputs because he has a large series of closed wedge high tibial osteotomy. He will give some inputs in between our talks. And then I am very much thankful again with Dr. Shiv Shankar and Dr. Naveen Thakkar and all speakers, those who have happily agreed to participate in this webinar. Thanks. Now I will not waste much time, and I will hand over to Dr. Sanjay Rastogi. He is the first speaker to discuss about the open wedge high tibial osteotomy. Thank you. Sanjay Rastogi, sir.
You have to unmute, sir. At the outset, I'd like to thank the Mr. President for having given this opportunity of having this talk on open wedge high tibial osteotomy. And when he became president, I requested him, he remembered it, and he has given all possible support. And I also take this opportunity to compliment IOA team for an excellent bone joint knee. So after the pre-basic webinar last month, all of us are convinced that SGO works for medial compartment osteoarthritis knee with tibia vara. And there are two types of osteotomies, open wedge high tibial osteotomy and closed wedge high tibial osteotomy. And as said, I'll be working on fixed angle implant Tomofix to fix this osteotomy of open wedge. So as Dr. Thakkar said, present in a manner so that the first surgery by his orthopedic surgeon could be easy. And I'm convinced the modern day orthopedic surgeons are convinced with use of rocking plate and minimally invasive procedures. So if they combine these two skills and learn the planning principles of Tomofix and surgical steps, in the first go, they'll be successful. Now, the ideal patient for open wedge high tibial osteotomy fixed with Tomofix is a physically active patient. The physiological age could be as much as 70 or even higher. We must remember the new age criterion in which 66 to 79 years is a middle age. And for our satisfaction, the oldest person operated in the world is 94 years. Patients, those who have tibia bone varus angle of more than 5 degrees respond better, and the incidence of this higher tibia vara is more in Asians, so it is rightly suited for this part of the world. The patient should have intact lateral compartment, he should have a normal range of motion, and if he has a deformity up to 20 degrees, it can be corrected by open wedge high tibial osteotomy. The patient should be willing to have unrestricted activity and range of motion, but at the price he will have to pay, there could be some pain when he is climbing the stairs or doing a strenuous activity. If patient has ACL PCL deficiency, it can be treated by open wedge high tibial osteotomy, and because of angular stable implant, obesity and smoking is not a contraindication. In preoperative planning, malalignment test, mechanical excess deviation and drawing for preoperative planning are essential. And most of us are familiar with the teaching of Dwar Pede and promoted by Dr. Mangal Parihar and Milin Chaudhary extensively for the last 2 decades. For this, we will need full length weight bearing x-rays, and the malrotation is avoided by aligning patella in the center of the femoral condyle. And this will help us to assess extent of knee arthritis and limb alignment. For correction of an average deformity, the weight-bearing line should pass through Fuji Sava point, and the Fuji Sava point is at the junction of the descent of the lateral tibial spine, and this is at the 62% of the tibial profile. The mechanical axis or the weight-bearing line normally passes up to 5 to 15 centimeters from the center of the knee joint, but if it's more than 15, it's indicated of tibia vara or varus deformity at the knee. And if we analyze this deformity and measure the angles of the joint, the most important being medial proximal tibial angle, and if it's below 85, this will contribute to this complaint of the patient, and if we correct this, patient will respond. Now to plan this open wedge high tibial osteotomy, we will have to draw a mechanical axis from the center of the hip to the center of the ankle. And then we draw the planned mechanical axis of the limb in the purple line. Then we mark the hinge point for the osteotomy, which is just proximal to tibio fibular joint at the lateral cortex of the tibia. And then we connect the hinge point to the center of the ankle, which is line A. Then we rotate line A onto the hinge point until it intersects with the planned mechanical axis of the limb. This being line B, and the angle between A and B is the alpha angle, which is the amount of correction would be required to correct the mechanical axis for this person. And we transverse this osteotomy alpha angle to the upper end with the center at the ura, which we have already marked, and the height on the medial cortex will give us the amount of opening which is required. If patient has a anterior knee instability, the slope could be decreased, the normal slope being up to 8 and 10. If we decrease it to 5, this will minimize the anterior vector force, but we have to avoid hyperextension of the knee. In cases when patients have posterior knee instability, tibial slope should be increased, and if we increase up to 12 degrees, slope creates an anterior vector force, but we must avoid flexion deformity at the knee. The learning objects for the principle of tomofix are the construction of the tomofix has to be understood. Tomofix was launched in 2000, and it is one stage internal fixator which has four proximal and four angle stable screws. And this allows opening up to 22 millimeters, and no interpositional material was used in the first 700 patients of the originator, and it led to a success. That means there was no need to put any interpositional. So this question is often asked, and the answer is clear. Tomofix, a biological internal fixator for metadiaphyseal osteotomies around the knee. Biological refers to preservation of bone and soft tissue, vitality, and biomechanical stability. It is made of pure titanium plates. Due to this, their biomechanical properties, including plastic deformation and good biocompatibility, it's an excellent implant. Osteosynthesis tomofix is based on the splinting principle. That means bridging osteotomy is grown. Altering load induced by the functional postoperative exercise and ambulation leads to micromotion, which promotes bone healing. So we have to understand this system allows early weight bearing. We should not be hesitant not to allow if we have done our procedure well. And this will lead to some micromotion and early union, like we see in Elizaro. So the Tomofix was first launched in 2000, and the same implant was used in 2010 when the new generation plates were introduced, which were standard and small. The small is specially suited for Asians. But the good part is they are biomechanically similar. The shape of the Tomofix is matched to the anatomy of proximal tibia with average 10 degrees valgus connection. There are four holes in the proximal part which are labeled as A, B, C, and D, and there are four in the distal part which are labeled as 1, 2, 3, 4. We must try to pay attention to this fact that they are A, B, C, D, and A, B, C, D, and 1, 2, 3, 4. Because this is the most important thing when we operate these patients to remember when we talk about various holes. The plates are identical for right and left side, hole A, B, C, and 1 and 2. No, A, B, C, and 3, 4 are 360 degree threaded hose, while D1 and 2 are 270 degree combination hose. They take the low profile screw heads for locking with a 4 Newton meter lifting torque screwdriver with a one click to avoid hole bending. During axial loading, bending force are distributed over a long area, and this avoids stress concentration, so the plate does not break. The plastic deformation of the plate occurs before the locking head screws start to move or bend, even when the plate is fixed for two hole. The hole ABC, that means the proximal holes, have an inclination of 11 degree quarterly to prevent perforation of tibial articular surface. Two spaces, that means distance plug, are used in hole D and 4 to keep the plate away from the periosteum. The proximal four holes, that means A, B, C, D, are convergent and are oriented anterior medially towards the lateral hinge, and they stabilize the hinge by spring suspension. The proximal end of the plate should lie as posterior as possible to have the long monocortical locking head screws. Plate holes in the longitudinal arm are 1, 2, 3, 4, and they are staggered. So this avoids longitudinal diaphyseal fissure. OWH2TO is a minimally invasive procedure. A 5 centimeter incision is sufficient for the osteotomy and for correct positioning the plate. After preparation of subcutaneous tunnel, implant is inserted in the distal direction and screw in hole 2, 3 and 4 are locked by a small additional incision. So it is truly a minimal invasive procedure. And this leads to soft tissue preservation. And Tomofix with spacer works as on the biological principles of bridging type osteosynthesis, which we use in comminuted fracture of the shaft of long bones. The spacers act as pillar of a bridge over osteotomy gap, and it gives some elasticity on the medial side and avoid pressure on the periosteum, pes encephalus, and MCL. The Tomofix has primary biomechanical stability, as the hinge is 10 mm lateral bone bridge, which is the cora, which is located at the proximal end of the tibiofibular joint and facilitates highest correction. Compression is achieved by temporary lag screw through hole 1, and disruption of the lateral hinge can occur in severe deformity, but this lateral hinge or disrupted lateral hinge can be reduced and stabilized by pre-stressing of the plate by means of two spacers and leg screw. And in the first series of 700 patients, no additional lateral fixation was required. The primary osseous stability is provided medially by the Tomofix, anteriorly by the bone behind the tibial tuberosity, laterally by the intact bone, the hinge, and posteriorly by the implant, which has a posteriorly directed long monocortical locking head screws. The first clinical results of 707 patients from 2000 to 2006, there was a decrease in visual analog score, that means pain score, from 4 to 1. Patients were pain-free, full weight bearing, without crutches, in 10 weeks time on an average. There was no neurological complication and only 3 required hip knee replacement. So to summarize, the Tomofix is a specific implant. It works on bridging principle. For correction up to 22 millimeters, no bone graft is required. It can be used in presence of osteoporosis. It is user friendly, allows easy handling, and good reproducibility. Tomofix cannot be substituted by proximal tibial plate, that means LCP, which is unsuited for open wedge high tee with osteotomy. This is another myth people will have to understand. Now, for the surgical technique, we'll discuss about the positional surgical steps and aftercare. The concept of biplanar osteotomy is again important. There is a transverse osteotomy and there is an ascending osteotomy. So the transverse osteotomy is parallel to the tibial slope. It is incomplete osteotomy and it is present in the posterior 2/3 or 3/4 of the bone. If the correction is large, then the anterior bone below the tuberosity has to be thicker. The ascending osteotomy is parallel to the tibial shin. It forms an angle of 100 to 110 degrees from the transverse osteotomy and it should exit proximal to the tibial tuberosity and anterior to the tibial joint line. Now the ascending osteotomy is made by a 0.45 millimeter thick blade. It is important that the thin blade has to be used because otherwise there is loss of bone and it delays healing. The transverse osteotomy should be made by 0.9 mm thick blade, not the joint replacement blade. And we must erase the superficial medial collateral ligament distal to the osteotomy. It allows us to go to the posterior medial cortex of the tibia and even opening of the osteotomy. A 5 millimeter long soft tissue preserving incision is made, starting 1 to 2 centimeters proximal to pes anserinus on the middle of the medial surface of tibia to preserve the infrapatellar branch of saphenous nerve. 3 distal locking screws are applied by a 1 centimeter small longitudinal incision over bone 3. The patient is positioned on an operation table with the contralateral leg lowered, and this is possible in some lower version operating tables, but otherwise patient can be placed on a customized 6 inches thick mattress. The patient is supported by a lateral support and a foot pad. This allows stabilization of the knee joint in 90 degree flexion and in complete extension. Patient is operated from the other side. The C-arm comes from the same side. This is the close-up view. So this mattress is cut so that the normal limb is below. So we have unrestricted view of AP and lateral for C-arm. Now, the starting point is at the cranial border of pes anserinus. And this coincides with the convex and concave medial border of tibia. So if we run our thumb on the medial side in the patient, the dip is the point where the osteotomy should be, and the pes anserinus is just distal to it. So if we palpate this well, we are in good position. The skin marking is done anteriorly. We mark the lower end of the patella, medial border of ligamentum patellae, tibial tuberosity, anterior and medial border of tibia, the pes anserinus. The incision is made in the middle part and 1 to 2 centimeters proximal to pes anserinus, and this is the joint line. On the lateral side, we mark the fibular head. 5 centimeter long soft tissue preserving incision is made, starting 1 to 2 centimeters proximal to pes anserinus, as just demonstrated. The medial and just proximal to pes anserinus, a 2.5 centimeter wide, laterally based fascioperiosteal flap is raised. This is the flap which is raised. This will ultimately help to cover the osteotomy anteriorly and laterally, so for early union, because the medial part takes some time. So if we use this flap, this heals faster. The proximal border of pes anserinus is identified and retracted distally through a sub pes anserinus bursa, which is present in the anterior part. Periosteum is elevated until the posterior medial quarter of the cortex of the proximal tibia. The proximal border of breast incisions retracted distally to expose the anterior border of long fibers of superficial MCL. And this is detached with the scalpel and a sharp periosteum elevator till the posterior medial cortex. And the MCL is erased distally so that there is even opening of the osteotomy, and this must be checked. This is the same step which trauma surgeon, this joint replacement surgeon do, and this is what area of the superficial MCL which needs erasing. Now the neurovascular structures are protected with a Hohmann retractor inserted subperiosteally anterior to popliteus muscle behind the tibia with knee in 90 degree flexion. For tibious slope internal navigation, a AP wire is passed in the center of tibia, 1 centimeter distal to the upper end of the tibia and parallel to the tibia slope in lateral view under CR. For internal navigation for transverse osteotomy, 2 2.5 millimeter guide wires are drilled to a point just proximal to tibial fibular joint in plane of the tibial slope under image intensifier, which is tilted 5 to 7 degrees to match the tibial slope. And once we do this, if we put the C-arm in the AP view, this AP wire is seen as a dot. And in this view, 2 wires should end at the lateral cortex, which is confirmed with C-arm with limb in 30 degree internal rotation. And in fact, there are 2 wires. They are in the plane of tibial slope, so only they are seen as one. The depth of the transverse osteotomy is determined by measuring the insertion depth of the guide wire with the help of another guide wire and scale. The measured depth of the transverse osteotomy is marked on the saw blade. And for making the osteotomy atraumatic, entire sewing procedure is performed very slowly with very little pressure under constant cooling of saw blade by irrigation. And this is the MRI which was taken immediately after the surgery, in which hematoma was seen at the osteotomy site and there was no bone edema. At 3 weeks, there are hyperintense granulation tissue surrounding the osteotomy site, which is a sign of healing, and the hematoma is reduced. And at 6 weeks, there is more granulation tissue, more healing, and the hematoma is further reduced in size. So this indicates the healing starts quite early. So the transverse osteotomy is done distal and parallel to the transverse guide wires, using them as a lathe with 0.9 mm thick plate with knee 90 degree flexion and the bone lever in the posterior part. The ascending osteotomy marking is done with knee in extension with blade perpendicular to the cortex, pointing in the posterior lateral direction in order to avoid slippage of the blade. While for doing the osteotomy, it is done in coronal plane, knee is kept in extension, and it is done by 0.45 millimeter thick saw blade, and the blade should be parallel to the ground. After the osteotomy, posterior cortex osteotomy is checked by palpation with a saw blade under CR, and the correction is maintained with the help of a bone spreader applied in the thick posterior medial cortex of tibia, and this is checked under CR. The intraoperative evaluation of correction in coronal plane is done with the alignment rod, which is placed from center of the hip to the center of the ankle, and it should pass from the Fujisawa point. If not, then we can fine tune it by opening or closing the spreader as needed. It is essential to use the gliding block for prepare the implant, because the screw holes are only in a bone which is only 3 mm, and there are only 2.5 mm double threads. So until unless the sleeves are fixed perfectly, the direction cannot be perfect. And the drill sleeve in hole B, it must be applied first. After that, we put drill sleeves in A and B, A and C in that order, and two spacers are put in hole D and 4. Tunnel for the longitudinal part of the tomofix is prepared with finger or surfer on the medial surface of tibia in the middle, so that the plate does not hang. The tomofix is pushed posteriorly onto the bone to have longest possible screws in hole A, B, C. And the T-arm should lie 1 centimeter distant and parallel to the tibial slope. Osteotomy gap should be in the center of the solid midsection of the plate. And in this position, temporary stabilization is done by a 2 mm K wire with 2 mm central drill sleeve in hole B, and the position is confirmed under CR. Two 3.5 drill bits are put in hole A and C to further stabilize the tomofix. Long monocortical locking head screws are applied in hole A, C, and B in this order, with power drill and tightened with a 4 Nm limitation torque screwdriver by a single click. Distally directed temporary lag screw is applied in hole 1 in neutral position, and the lateral hinge is compressed under CR. The lag screw in neutral position in hole 1 does not change the amount of correction at the osteotomy, and the distally directed lag screw remains away from the trajectory of the final locking head screw. So lag screw in neutral position in hole 1 puts the distal osteotomy segment towards the plate. Lag screw forces the plate into suspension, creating elastic preload, compresses the lateral hinge, and due to spacers, the periosteum and pes incisionis is not pressed. And distal fixation is done through a stabbed incision over hole 3, which is easily palpable just proximal to the spacer head in hole 4, and a short monocortical locking head screws are applied in hole 3 and 2. The spacer from the hole 4 is removed and replaced by a short monocortical locking head screw and lock. Locking screw in hole 1 is replaced by a bicortical locking head screw, and the lag screw which is removed is discarded because it gets deformed. A long monocortical locking head screw is applied in hole D and lock. The fascio periosteal flap is stitched distally to cover the osteotomy. A proximally exiting overflow drain without lavage is put in to maintain the hematoma in place. A compression bandage is applied for 8 minutes, and this time it applies to check the correction under CR. The final evaluation is done with image intensifier in 2 plate, wound is closed in layer, dressed, and a compression bandage applied. This is a usual orthopedic care, but a clinical and logical evaluation is done by an AP and lateral view of the knee and full length weight bearing x-ray in AP view. And follow-up evaluations are done at 6, 12, 24, and 52 weeks. The early signs of union on MRI are seen even on day 4 to day 6. The union starts in the osteotomy gap from anterior lateral area to posterior and progresses posterior medially. Consolidation normally takes place 1 to 1.5 years. And due to oblique pain of the osteotomy, x-rays are not reliable in conventional technique. We have to take access in the plane of the osteotomy if you want to visualize these union better. Now, this is the most important thing. These patients should undergo a functional rehabilitation as tolerated by the patient. The concept that the patient will have to be in bed for a long is not there. Patient should be start isometric quadriceps exercise from day one, early range of motion so that the flexion over 90 degrees is achieved within few days. It is an extra articular surgery. Partial weight bearing as tolerated by bilateral crutches should be started, and full weight bearing could be started as early as 4 to 6 weeks with intensive muscle training and gait training. Patient can undertake a sporting activity and heavy work at 6 months, and Tomofix, if need be, can be removed in 1 to 1.5 years' time when the union has taken place. Now, there's a question sometimes asked is, can this procedure be done simultaneously? And it is not indicated at least two secondary loss of correction due to overload. So one should not try to do both together. In a bilateral condition, the site with more pain is operated first, and there should be gap of at least 1 to 1.5 years between the two interventions once it is consolidated well. So the take home message would be, overload medial compartment osteoarthritis knee is in physically active individuals should be treated by open wedge high tibial osteotomy fixed with Tomofix. We should not be thrashed. We should not close our eyes to evidence, science, surgical skill, and need of our population to sit in the squat on the floor for activity of daily living. Thank you for your time and attention.
Thank you, Sanjay Rastogi, for this excellent presentation and to clear all the points which usually every beginner would have in their mind. I don't know whether there is any question or not, but otherwise we may take question and answer at last, and we can hand over the screen to the Dr. Mangal Parihar. Welcome, Dr. Mangal Parihar.
Thanks. So I'm going to show you some kind of critical points for how we do the fixator-assisted osteotomy, and then a couple of questions which are always asked. This video of the how the osteotomy is done is also available on the web. So I'm going to give a little more time to issues of lateral hinge breakage, which is a question that is always asked. So this is the fixator that we use. It has two proximal pins, which are in a sort of T fashion. There is a self-aligning clamp, which is like a hinge, but basically it allows the proximal portion to move relative to the distal. There is a distraction unit, and then there are two distal pins which are put in. So all in all, it's only 4 pins. Now, this has to be differentiated from, this is the fixator that we use. It's not the same as an LRS fixator with a T clamp. It's not the same as a standard orthofix fixator with a T clamp, because this hinge is missing. Here, once you tighten the ball joint, it doesn't move. The T cannot move in relation to this vertical limb. Whereas here, it can still move. So that part is important. The most important part of the putting on the fixator is to get this posterior pin. There are 2 pins in the tibia. One is anterior, one is posterior. So the posterior one has to be as posterior as possible, because the AP dimension of the tibia, especially in females, is pretty small. So if you don't get that pin very much posterior, you risk the anterior one not having a good hold. So therefore, I will always put in this pin over a K wire. That is, I put in a K wire if that position is appropriate, where I'm looking at it as posterior as possible. Then I drill over it with a 4.5 cannulated drill bit and then put the tapered shan screw. So at the end, this is how it should look. One posterior, one anterior. Now, despite this, we usually, the distance in the pins is only 1 if you take the posterior, 1 and 3 or 1 and 4. We never get 1 and 5, right? So the osteotomy is distal to the tuberosity, which is somewhere over here. And the reason for doing that is the distal to tuberosity osteotomy doesn't affect the patellar height. Whereas if you do it proximal, it will affect the patellar height unless you do a vertical limb, which Dr. Rastogi showed. Also, it doesn't increase the patellofemoral contact pressure. So this is the osteotome in the direction of the osteotomy. So it is still going according to the principles of deformity correction, where usually we get the cora somewhere around the tip of the fibula. So this looks very similar to what Dr. Rastogi just described, that there is an intact lateral hinge. And we are aiming for that osteotomy, though we are starting below the tuberosity, we are aiming for the tip of the fibula. And this is the difference between what Sanjay said and the way that we do. The AO osteotomy is a little higher maybe, and there is this vertical limb so that the patellar tendon is spared. I go a little distal to the insertion of the patellar tendon on the tuberosity. I'll show you a few bits of, so putting on the fixator is not a problem. We put on the fixator, two transverse pins and two vertical pins. Then the fixator is taken off and with an incision on the posterior medial border of the tibia, right? I create a soft tissue tract using a scissor, put it in closed, open and withdraw. With this scissor, you can feel actually the posterior, posteromedial border. I like to use this curved on curved 5 mm synthesis periosteal elevator. And this is one of the instruments that I classify under don't leave home without it, because you can actually cut in the depth, the periosteum, and then run that periosteum while feeling the posterior border of the tibia. So this is completely applied on the posterior border of the tibia, and I ensure that it is in the right direction. While I'm putting it into that right direction, I'm also doing what I call a windshield wiper effect, so that the periosteum in that region is loose and hangs down. So normally this is just to show that this periosteum is well applied to the posterior border of the, and you can actually feel it when I'm running it like that. You can feel the posterior border, that curve in the periosteum helps that. Then we raise the periosteum starting from the same point on the medial surface of the tibia. So the lateral part is not touched at all. And you can feel the periosteum come out from the front over there. Through that same hole in the periosteum, we make multiple drill holes in the direction of the intended osteotomy, starting posteromedial, going towards the lateral side, aiming for the tip of the fibula. Also one which goes slightly from the medial side and goes through the posterior cortex somewhere in the middle. So this provides a stress riser to minimize the chance of the osteotomy exiting into the pin sites. So once this is done, we use an osteotome in the same track, and because this has been pre-drilled, that becomes relatively easy. The osteotome to use here is a thin 10 mm synthesis. There is a, what they call a Lambert osteotome, so that you are causing minimal sort of damage to the bone, this one. Okay, so again, this instrument is worth its weight in gold, and you can actually place it, if you're worried, under the C-arm to see that only 2-3 mm of the osteotome is behind the posterior cortex, and then under AP guidance, you direct it towards the head of the fibula. Multiple gentle blows completes that osteotomy pretty well. So that's the AP that you see now. The direction is okay, so we will go further till we reach a centimeter short of the lateral cortex of the tibia. Once that posterior cortex is cut, then the angle of the osteotome is changed to go along the medial cortex of the tibia. So we are now cutting the medial cortex. Sometimes the medial cut may be a little more transverse relative to the posterior cut, so that you're not going to damage the tibial tuberosity and the insertion. When this is cut, you are usually able to get opening of the osteotomy, and the lateral cortex remains intact. So this is an osteotomy now, which is unstable enough that it can be opened with minimal force, but the lateral hinge keeps it stable so that a relatively unstable fixator can be used to achieve this correction. The final part is to place this, this is just an internally rotated view to show that the lateral cortex, posterolateral cortex, is completely intact and the osteotomy is going in the region of the tibiofibular joint. So then is to put the fixator on. As you can see, that hinge over there is completely loose. And it's a hinge, so therefore it has a hinge axis. The fixator is tightened onto the pins, leaving about a finger breadth and a half to allow for pin side dressing, etc. And then a wire is put into that hinge. And the hinge is oriented in the complete AP plane. The X-ray is done with the patella facing forward, and this hinge is oriented so that it's completely vertical. And then the ball joints on the fixator are tightened. So now whatever distraction happens on that fixator is only going to correct in the coronal plane. And therefore, when you use a fixator, there is never a change in the slope. Whatever was the slope will remain. So in cases where I need to change the slope, I cannot use this fixator. So once that is tightened, you can do a trial distraction to know how many days of distraction roughly will be required. So after we've distracted it for a certain number of millimeters, so here we are distracting it. And with the corticoid, you come to know that this is central. So this way you can estimate that, okay, this patient will need 20 days of distraction or 24 days of distraction, whatever. Once that is done, this is how much distraction will be needed. So we shut it down again, lock the fixator, and a patient goes out. So after 1 week of rest, they do distraction of 0.25 millimeters four times a day. Usually most patients, 21 to 28 days is the rough amount of distraction that they require. Till the bone is straight, I allow touchdown weight bearing. They have to do daily pin site care, and I put a lot of stress on the physiotherapy, quadriceps, hip abductors, as well as ankle. We've gone through this before. What is the correct valgus? I aim for a HKA measured on the medial side of between 183 to 186. That is a mechanical axis valgus of 3 to 6 degrees, and the weight bearing line passing through the base of the tibial spine. That is commonly known as the Fujisawa point. So once the correction has occurred and the fixator is locked, they can go on to weight bearing as tolerated. Most patients will come on to a stick by 6 weeks and no support by 8 to 10 weeks. It takes 3 months for full healing, and the fixator is removed in the OPD at 3 months. Now, in relation to this, whenever I talk on this, there are always a couple of questions that come up, common questions, and I will address those. One is, in some of my videos, I put, you'll see that the pins are parallel to the joint, but that's not mandatory. Like in this patient, you can see that the pins are not parallel. They are way angled. And how I usually try to go parallel, but it's not absolutely necessary, especially when patients have got, if you notice carefully, the distance of the fibular head from the joint varies in patient to patient. So sometimes if the fibular head is too close to the joint and you want to go parallel, the medial side of your pin is also very close to the joint. In those cases, I will angle it a little more. Also, when there is a large angle to be corrected, I will angle it, like this patient. Now, she had an osteotomy on the left side, I think about 7-8 years ago. This was before we were well aware of the concept of a DFO. And she was doing well. So she said, why should I do a DFO? Even though today, if I have to do this, I would do a DFO for her. So you can see that this is joint is slightly oblique here. So she needed a correction. Now her tibia itself is pretty much in varus, plus about 4 degrees from the femur has to be compensated in the tibia. So here, when I put it in like this, I get more available distraction in the fixator. Otherwise, the fixator runs out of this distractor. So this is when it has just come to normal. I think this is about 14 days or 15 days of distraction. And by the time she came to complete correction, that is the valgus, two things to notice. One is she has fractured. The second is she is almost running out of the distractor. Though there is more distractor here, if it goes much more than this, it would become unstable. So that excessive angulation or the angulation of the proximal pins has helped me to do a little more than what I would normally do. Right? And this pin site, the hinge fractures are usually not a problem if they occur late, like this guy. Okay. This was his planning. You can see that after the osteotomy, his hinge, lateral hinge is intact. He required 26 days of distraction according to our plan. 7 days of distraction, hinge is intact. 17 days of distraction, you'll just notice the break in the lateral cortex over here. So probably this osteotomy was not deep enough. But because this is gradual distraction, all of these so-called late fractures will show callus and healing, and they continue to be stable. 26 days, the callus allows us to continue that distraction till we get it to the appropriate. So now after 26 days of distraction, he's got overcorrection. So we reduce this angle by compressing on the fixator and get it to the appropriate angle, which is 185, and the mechanical axis through Fujisawa point. That's 2 months post-op. You can see good healing to almost at a time of removal. And here, this callus which you see is the importance of that posterior raising of the periosteum that I do, because it gives a good callus, a peripheral callus at the back also, since there's good musculature there. 3 months is well healed and fixator is ready for removal. That's 6 months. Now, the other thing that people who are starting off worry about is, what if the hinge fractures when I'm doing the osteotomy? So this was a guy where we did put on the fixator. No problem as far as the surgery goes. But 10 days later, while getting off the bed, he fell and broke the lateral hinge. So this was not from surgery. This was a complete break, and you can see the amount of displacement even before he had done. He had done probably 2 or 3 days of distraction. So here, this is not stable. You can obviously see the displacement of the proximal. So this needs some form of fixation. So similar, if this thing happens on table, you would need to take similar action. So here, what we did was reduced that by the rotation and reduction of the distraction, and then put in 2 screws through a small incision on the lateral side, and put a loop of stainless steel wire around that. Now, as both of these screws advance, the distance between the screw heads becomes larger, and therefore it pulls that lateral thing together. You could also put in a plate. I thought this was more dynamic. So this is the post-operative picture. So you can see just a small incision so that we are able to pass in whatever we need to pass over there. Gave him rest for another 7 to 10 days, and then started gradual distraction, which this is at 2 weeks. Some distraction has happened. At 3 weeks, he's fully straight. At 3.5 weeks, he achieved the desired correction, which is a mechanical axis of 186. 5 weeks follow-up, 2.5 months, 3 months, 4 months. Because that initial period had taken up a little of the time. So once 2/3 of this area is healed, and you can see that there is posterior callus, the fixator can be taken off. So that's the 5 month follow-up, 10 months, walking well, 20 months, everything is healed without any trouble. So if the lateral hinge breaks early, you have to stabilize it. Otherwise, this system is not stable enough, or you have to change to some other modality of fixation. And the worst thing that can happen is a hinge fracture as well as delayed healing. This is a doctor actually who had her right side as well as her left side done. So this is 6 months following her left HTO, which was not really showing signs of healing. And she was having trouble even in terms of proper weight bearing. She's not able to weight bear, and there is a little bit of a limp, which to me says that, you know, there is a clinical problem. So you can see her thing, though this had fractured late with the distraction, she had not thrown callus, and overall the healing in that was deficient. Now in this case, this fixator again is not stable enough. So we took out that fixator, the angle was maintained, and then put on a standard T-shaped fixator, which allows us to make the whole system more stable, freshened that osteotomy site, injected a bone graft substitute, that is Genex, so that we could do it through a small incision, and that's the small incision that was there. And the fixator was changed to a more stable. You can see the pins of the original fixator. So this is now holding closer to the osteotomy, and it's a fixed device. An LRS with a T-clamp still put from the medial side, following which she healed without any further issues. At 6 months, she was healed well, no problem in terms of pain, walking well. That's 6 months following when we took off the fixator. That's her right knee, which had been operated earlier. So she took, on both the sides actually, she took a long time. But overall, it was well worth it, despite what may seem like a lot of damage in terms of osteophytes, etc. You can see the amount of flexion she has on the extreme right. This was in two years follow-up and 3 years follow-up in 2019. And that's her now in 2021. Continues to be very, very active without any symptoms. So fixator assisted HTO, how to do it, and if you run into trouble, how to deal with it. Thank you.
Mangal, I have a question.
Yes.
Did you have any time to make a change in the slope? Did you do an osteotomy like what we do with the Tomopix, as shown by Dr.
Yes.
Sanjay Rastogi?
Yeah. Quite a few times where the patient has an ACL deficiency, for example, or the patient has a flexion deformity. There I will change the slope, but I cannot use the fixator then. Either I will use, depending on how much needs to be changed, either I will use a Tomofix or I will use a Ilizarov. With this fixator, because of that hinge, it will only change in one plane. You cannot change the flexion extension. You cannot change the slope. So if that is why all my patients, I do an X-ray in maximum extension. And if there is a flexion deformity, those patients will be then counseled for a Tomofix. Usually, if it's something very complex, then an Ilizarov. But usually, if both things are required, that is, slope also needs to be changed, then it's a Tomofix more often than not.
Yeah. See, you have kept the hinge with a pin vertically initially.
Yes.
Can you change the direction of the pin to change the direction of the distraction, and you can instead of using a Tomofix, can you change the slope?
You can, but the problem is that I don't know how to quantify that. Meaning, I can't say that for 10 degrees of varus valgus correction, there will be 3 degrees of slope correction. If I could quantify that, then yes, you can rotate that. But that is a non-quantifiable thing as of now, at least. Maybe a little more research and study will show. But because it is non-quantifiable, and that correction of the slope is critical in those patients, then I don't use the fixator.
Okay. I've got a question, Mangal. Do you do bilateral simultaneously?
No. I do it one of two ways. One is I will do it once it is straight and the patient can bear full weight on that leg. So by about 6 weeks, I can do the other side. Advantage of that is the overall recovery period becomes around 4 months. The other option is, which I tell patients, is that, you know, you after 3 months, once you are convinced that this has worked for you on this side, then when we take off the fixator, we can do the other side. So that is the second way. Most patients who have almost equal pain on both sides, that is, can't differentiate, aaj ye dukh raha hai, kal wo dukh raha tha, kind of thing. There, I will do this 6-week interval. But otherwise, if one is paining more, then you do that one first and do the second one a little later.
But somehow, all the cases where I advise bilaterally, I have ended up doing only unilaterally because the patient has never come back for the other side. They are so happy with one side, they somehow manage. I'm yet to do a bilateral one.
No, and I think the, when one is more and the other is less, what is playing is probably that because one side is very painful, they are now tending to load the other, the so-called normal side more. And that is symptomatic. The moment you make the affected side okay, they start weight bearing well on that and the pressure on the other side goes away. So then they will, so a lot of the patients that I do bilateral, they will be not bilateral in the sense, both sides, they will come after 6 years, 7 years for the other side.
Yeah.
And they follow that principle, which I say that you have to sell it to the patient for the first time. And the second time the patient has to buy it. So they come back 6, 7, abhi ye wala dukne lag gaya, you know. So then don't require much convincing.
I think this is a common experience. Even the same experience, Mangal, what I am getting in my cases, the second one they come after years, not immediately.
This is what I've been thinking. Why? But I think that's the reason.
The reason is the pain in both the limbs is not always equal. So there are different line. The deformity is different. This could be one reason, but there are some patients who come back.
That's what I said. One is more affected. Yes. One is more affected, so they come for that.
Mangal, one question for the old age patients, those who are in osteoporotic bones. Do you think that the holding of the pin will last long because of the severe osteoporosis on those patients?
First of all, I think severe osteoporosis is a little bit of a judgmental thing, especially now. With digital X-rays, some of that osteoporosis is created by the radiographer, depending on how much contrast he gives. But certainly a 70-year-old, I probably would not think about a fixator unless they were very, very active, you know, which means that their bones are in good shape because of their constant walking, weight bearing, etc. But in the patients that I have done, 65 years and all that, I haven't had a problem. I must point out one of the tricks that I use there is cancellous bone, even in a 45 and a 50-year-old, would be a little soft. So I drill only the proximal end of it with a 4.5. The rest of it, I drill with a 3.2. So I kind of stuff that 5 to 6 mm pin inside. And usually once that bone has formed, it becomes a weight bearing or load sharing implant. So there's not so much load coming on the pin. By about 6 weeks, 8 weeks, that callus has started to ossify and I haven't had a problem. Like I showed you this lady, she was 6 months in the fixator and still there was no loosening in that.
Do you MRI in certain patients where there is a mechanical problem in the knee as well?
Right now, to tell you the truth, I do an MRI in almost every patient, but it's largely for academic reasons more than clinical reasons. In the sense that I want to see what is the cartilage today. I want to see what is the cartilage 3 years, 4 years, 5 years down the line. But certainly if the patient complains of, the other thing is oftentimes patient comes with an MRI.
Right.
And somebody has told the patient that, you know, you need an arthroscopy for a degenerative tear, etc. But otherwise, I will tend to do an MRI if one, there is a mechanical symptom, and two, if there is some X-ray evidence of lateral problem. So I want to confirm that the lateral cartilage is largely okay before I shift it onto the lateral side. So I would say by that yardstick, maybe 1 in 5 or 6 patients would justify an MRI. But currently, we do an MRI for almost 80-90% of the patients, but that's mainly for a academic, mainly for an academic reason.
The last question on my side,
sir.
The last question from my side is that sometimes the patient comes with the little advanced stage of varus and the medial degeneration. And on X-ray, we see that the lateral compartment is reasonably good.
Yeah.
But clinically, when we examine the patient, they have got the lateral edge of the tibiofibular joint and patellofibular joint. They are tender. They are tender and they complain also little on that side. Are these are the patient we can operate?
Yes and no. One of the reasons for pain on the lateral side with significant varus is stretch of the lateral ligaments, etc. So I have to be convinced that maybe that is playing a role. Second, as I said, an MRI, which will show me that overall the cartilage is okay. And third is the age. So if this patient was, 55, 60, then I would discuss it with them. If the patient was 35 and 40, I would still go ahead with an osteotomy, explaining it to them. But I would put my weight on the osteotomy. A 55, 60-year-old, I would tell them that osteotomy is good. Medial unicondylar is also available. You have to think about it. But I've done these extended indications now where I do a femoral as well as a tibial osteotomy, as well as a debridement of all the osteophytes, including a large part of the issue is a notch osteophyte, which causes a flexion deformity. So if I take off all the osteophytes and do a proper realignment, which I also call TKR, total knee realignment. So with that, patients have been doing, the limited number that I have done, have done well. So I'm not very pessimistic about them. I am carefully optimistic about even those patients.
One question from my side. One case you have shown that after some issues of union probably, and you have changed to the fixed fixator instead of distracting fixator. In that case, could we think of fixing it with other locking plate or tomofix like
absolutely
that?
yes you can. This was a patient who, she was actually a doctor herself, and she was functioning pretty well with the fixator even in that the non-united mode. So she was very comfortable with just small incisions and putting on the fixator. I've had patients who have come to me with non-unions of HTOs done elsewhere, where I've gone in and put in a tomofix, right? Absolutely. I mean, as Sanjay pointed out, that the tomofix is also an internal fixator. Yes. So what I need is to hold the proximal and the distal fragment in a particular position to each other while nature does the healing and whatever graft and all that we put. So whether you want to use a plate or a fixator, absolutely, it's absolutely okay.
One another thing that once we have operated on one side, that you may have done a gradual medial open wedge. So in every open wedge, I have observed that there is some lengthening of limb. Is it, you must have observed, because you may have done more than many hundreds.
Yes. HTO. Yeah, the lengthening happens from two reasons. One is any bent thing which is straightened, or the converse, any straight thing which is bent will shorten. Mm. So there is some lengthening occurring from there, and there is some lengthening occurring from the wedge. But from the wedge, it's not more than 4 or 5 millimeters, because if you open a 10 mm wedge, the maximum lengthening you will get is about 5 mm. And that is something which is explained. No patient has ever complained of it, that they've had such a significant lengthening that they find it, they notice it, that this leg feels longer now. I say, yes, it is a little longer. At the most, you can wear a little bit of an insole if you get bothered about it. But never been a clinical problem.
Or one thing, another thing, what you have discussed is many times you have recommended on opposite side after 6 weeks. So that means for one another 6 to 8 weeks, you may have a fixator on both sides.
Both legs, yeah. So they have to walk a little awkwardly, but the way I put the fixator is not bang medial, it's anteromedial. So the sort of clashing between the two fixators doesn't really happen. It's a little unwieldy walk, but they get by. If someone who's working for leave and all that, they have issues. So they have to ultimately balance both of those things. So from that point of view, it's acceptable.
And one another thing that I want to congratulate you, because I discuss with very young orthopedic surgeons, those who have performed either a single or a few high tibial osteotomies, they are with fixators only. They find it more easy. And another things, they have feel safe themselves because there is no soft tissue dissection much, and precision can be done after the surgery also.
Surgery. So, that's, I think, one of the biggest advantages that I myself have found. I mean,
and the second thing, they can get very good guidance from even your YouTube videos. You lot of YouTube videos, so they watch plenty of times before performing, and here in Gujarat also, if they have done twice or thrice a high tibial osteotomy, that is with fixator only. That's a good that you it becomes more popular.
That's one of the reasons why I wanted to add this about the hinge today rather than only the technique, because that's one of the questions which constantly gets asked. So I said today we'll you know answer that with pictures, which makes it much clearer.
Yes, Milind Chaudhary has a question. Milind, you have to unmute and ask, or you wanted to add something.
Well, it's a very interesting discussion. The question was about lateral joint line tenderness. I create, you know, lot of trouble to find out whether the joint line tenderness is real or it is spurious. So there are ladies, middle-aged ladies, if you touch them anywhere, they will complain of pain. So the first time you touch their lateral joint line, they will complain of pain. But then what I do is I start palpating them on the shin. I start palpating them on the shin. And then I palpate the opposite limb. And, you know, I palpate, you know, their forearms. I palpate their humeri, deep palpation. And then they get the point, you know, and then I come back to the lateral compartment. And then if they really have tenderness elicitable on the lateral compartment, then it's sure that this is lateral compartment involvement. And that is not very common. And if there is a doubt, then the only way to ascertain, I think, from what I have understood, is to do not just an MRI, because is to do a SPECT CT scan. Because that will tell you that, you know, the uptake levels in the lateral compartment, the presence of osteophytes is not certain. In a way of determining that the lateral compartment is involved. So, you know, taking a decision about performing the osteotomy and whether you can call it an extended indication is Mangal's being very diplomatic. But we are all knee-preserving surgeons, and that's part of our indication. We don't think that it's extended. So we just make sure that there isn't a lateral joint line tenderness.
One question to Dr. Sanjay Rastogi. Sir, in Tomofix, you have said that all locking bolts are unicortical. I think you don't purchase the opposite cortex. Both in proximal and distal fragment, both?
No, the screw in hole one is bicortical.
Pardon?
Screw in hole one is bicortical.
Okay, screw is okay. But locking, that you replaced it after? Removing and
I'm talking of the same locking head screw in hole one, which you replace after removing the lag screw, has to be bicortical.
Okay. Is there any advantage not to purchase opposite cortex?
It is not needed. If you are not sure of the osteoporosis, then you can purchase the other cortex also in all four distal ones. but not in the proximal ones.
Is there any advantage of not purchasing the opposite cortex? Because usually I purchase on both the sides.
I follow the way it's been practiced and it has given good results internationally. So I follow the same. But if there's osteoporosis, you can always put bicortical in hole one and hole two. I have a question to Mangal. When you talk of osteoporosis, yeah, then do you think DEXA would help?
I said no. First of all, I think osteoporosis is a big scam. On DEXA, you can't differentiate between osteoporosis and osteomalacia, number one. Number two, if osteoporosis is such a big problem, these machines have been available for how many years now? Still, there is no data of Indian women or Indian men for that matter. All the data that you are using is X number of years old of white Caucasian women to define what is osteoporosis. So to me, DEXA and all that, all these companies come with that bloody ultrasonic heel reading thing, run a camp just so that they can dispense off their medication.
Ultrasound, so, titanium is different, but DEXA, which is internationally accepted, you...
I know. So you tell me why there is no data on Indian women, if it is that important.
I think people have not applied themselves. I use it extensively.
Yeah, but it's racially huge difference here. White Caucasian woman versus an Indian woman. And the most important thing is DEXA cannot be, see, in the West where, say, osteomalacia may not be an issue. Vitamin D deficiency may not be an issue. DEXA cannot differentiate between osteomalacia and... So when you get a patient with low DEXA, you give them the alendronate also, and you give them the vitamin D also, and you give them the calcium also.
The way I understand is they have to be given calcium and vitamin D for everybody.
Exactly. So why that means there is a deficiency of that?
Right. And if there's an osteomalacia on other bone blood test, you can find out. The other question which I wanted to...
Dr. Rastogi, if I may interject. Yes. Mangal said something about the guys coming in with the machines. So this is like the movie, The Pursuit of Happiness. Will Smith is very poor and he's got a son to take care of and he's going around selling these DEXA machines, if you remember that movie.
Right. But I have never ever used this portable DEXA machines. I only rely on DEXA, which is the right machine anyway. The other question which was, when you take a MRI, the evaluation of the cartilage is neither specific nor sensitive. So what is your take on that?
No, on 1.5 and 3 Tesla machines, it is extremely sensitive and specific, especially if you do the GEMRIC protocol, you can very clearly see the cartilage areas of... change and all that. The uptake in GEMRIC is different depending on the collagen state of that cartilage. Very clearly it can be seen. That's, I don't think there is a doubt on that as far as I'm concerned. On good machines with GEMRIC protocol, I don't know if it's a protocol or what, you know, where you get the cartilage colored in different colors depending on what is the content. So there's a blue, green, yellow and red kind of range. And so different cartilage quality will have those different colors. So that part I leave to the sort of radiologist, but even visually you get a good idea of what it is like.
Because
they are sensitive and specific.
But per se, for deciding whether to conserve the knee or not, they are not being used. That was my...
No, the point I'm trying to
say is... Higher generation machines, I have no idea.
No, I'm not saying that I use the MRI to decide for an osteotomy. I use that information on an MRI, which shows me that in a sort of outlier where I'm wondering, should I do it or not? So in that, if I find that the lateral cartilage is poor, then I may take a step back. That's about it. but not for the average run-of-the-mill. They don't need, that's what I told him. I do it mainly right now for academic purposes, but otherwise only maybe 1 in 6, 1 in 7 would really justify an MRI. So in that sense, yes, you're right. I agree.
I think we have to move ahead.
Yeah.
Yes, already 11:30.
I invite Dr. Milind Chaudhary for his further talk on limitations of open wedge high TPL osteotomy and complications of high TPL osteotomy.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. So, good morning, gentlemen. Thank you for your very kind invitation to participate in the IOA HTO webinars. This is a very interesting topic. The opening wedge osteotomy, after you listen to Dr. Sanjay Rastogi's beautiful and very complete exposition of the subject and the operative technique, and the wonderful results that you can get with the TomoFix. And after you listen to Mangal's masterful exposition of external fixators, the average orthopedic surgeon would be forgiven for believing that we have found the ultimate answer for, you know, osteoarthritis of the knee. Not only because the both of them are doing such wonderful work and they have said it so nicely, but also because of the inherent human bias that when you come across something new, you find that you have found the ultimate answer. I would just like to begin by quoting my old anatomy teacher in KM Hospital, the great Dr. Manu Kothari. He says that if our expanding knowledge is like the inner surface of a balloon, then the outer surface of the balloon is our ignorance. So with a sense of discovery and adventure, let us look at this journey of knee preserving surgery in which the opening wedge osteotomy, whether done by an external fixator or done by the fantastic TomoFix plate system, is one milestone along the way. Having said that, my brief today is to speak on limitations and complications of the opening wedge. Now, there's no doubt, as I said, that you know, you have some patients like this lady pathologist, 47 years of age. She's subjected to 3 arthroscopies in the knee at 47 for a standard medial compartment osteoarthritis with a mild varus deformity. And for 3 years, she goes back and forth, and she's a friend, wife of a dear friend, ophthalmic surgeon. And you just have to perform a standard medial opening wedge TomoFix with all the steps outlined by Dr. Sanjay very nicely. And she is completely relieved of pain. Within a few months, she's willing and ready to do her daughter's marriage and stuff like that. Or for example, this orthopedic surgeon who comes to me with a mild varus deformity, but he's had an ACL repair, he's got tuberculosis in the past. Nobody wants to touch him. And everybody's worried, people are doing MRI after MRI. And all you have to do is very judiciously and carefully perform a minimally opening wedge osteotomy in which you do not take the mechanical axis to the Fujisawa point, because he wants to run. He's a runner and he cannot bear the thought of not running. So if you take him to the Fujisawa point, he's going to develop a valgus, which is going to prevent him from running. So you do it carefully. See the small wedge, it's 5.5 millimeters. And the videos are not going to run, but this gentleman messaged me last month saying he ran 458 kilometers in the last month. And that's the power and the beauty of the opening wedge. Definitely. So this is another orthopedic surgeon from the city where I was born. He comes to me and he says, just do my, you know, surgery. And, you know, we do it. And he gets the surgery and, you know, 48 hours later, he's willing to drive back 1,000 kilometers to go home. And he's doing just fine. So these are the successful stories we know. This is a lady gynecologist who comes to us with this problem. So step by step, we measure 3.5 centimeters from the joint line. We pass in a guide wire in this 45 degree internal rotation view, just above the tibiofibular joint. We take our sharp osteotome to open the posteromedial cortex, and then a saw, and then with super sharp osteotomes, which we sharpen just before surgery. And you intentionally break the lateral cortex. As Dr. Rastogi was kind enough to introduce me to Professor Staubli at Jaipur, who said that we intentionally create the lateral cortex fracture. And that's what we do. And then you stack the osteotomes, you open it up. This is the biplanar osteotomy. And you separate it apart with the spreader. And then you check with the guy, you know, the rod, and make sure you're not beyond the lateral cortex. And then, you know, you retain the spreader posteriorly, you put in the plate, the wires at the top. And after fixing the three screws at the top, this is the crucial step, the golden screw, which tenses and compresses the hinge, which sets up the whole system of elasticity and sustained compression, which does not need bone grafting. And here she is with a wonderful result, with no problems, just the right amount of correction. Now, this is the ideal scenario. So I'm very happy myself. Until 2014, I thought I had found mother lode. There's no need for anything else. Because quite honestly, I have been doing external fixators for high tibial osteotomy for now 32 years. But I can tell you, a lot of middle-aged and elderly ladies just don't want an external fixator. Regardless of what Dr. Dinesh says, young surgeons are happy with the external fixator. Old ladies are not. I can tell you that. Old ladies are not happy with the external fixator. And so the Tomofix plating system has come a long way. So this is a 77-year-old lady, mother of the teacher of my youngest child. Severe pain, severe agony. She could not walk. We can do the Tomofix, you know. She's got perfect 66 degrees, a slight overcorrection, but the joint lines are normal. In the act of correcting her deformity, she developed the classic type 3 hinge fracture. That's the fracture line goes into the joint. Because many years ago when I started, I used to stop short of the osteotomy much prior to the lateral cortex, because you're worried about creating the hinge fracture. But the truth is, if you go all the way to the lateral cortex, then the fracture line is not going to break into the joint. So she got that, but we can detect it on the table and just put in a screw, and that will solve the problem. And you know, she's completely free from pain. She's zero pain 7 years after surgery. So overcorrection can create problems. So the first problem that we should think about is the hinge fracture in the Tomofix system. So this is the type one, which is at the lateral cortex. But as I have tried to show you, Professor Staubli said, and after 2 years of performing, up to about 3 or 4 years, we learned that you have to go all the way to the lateral cortex. This way it prevents the fracture from going up into the joint, which is a type 3. And this is a type 2, the one that migrates below the tibial head. If it goes below the, you know, the tibial head, it's a very unstable situation. And you can lose your correction, you can get more valgus deformity, and you can run into difficulties and problems. And the, you know, the type 3 we've already spoken about. So this is the diagrammatic representation. This is a type 1 when people are stopping short. This is the type 2, which is the really unstable one. And the type 3 we can detect on the table and just fix with the screw. It's probably the least harmful of the hinge fractures. So this wonderful diagram from Japan shows where you should aim. The aim of the osteotomy is to go, you know, within the tibiofibular joint. The W represents the within, the A is above, the B is below. Within the tibiofibular joint, within and lateral, not within and medial. Okay, you draw a line extending from the lateral cortex of the tibia. So you want to stay within the tibiofibular joint and lateral to this lateral tibial line. You don't want to be above, you don't want to be below to create these problems. So, you know, this is the wife of the matriarch of a great man who's a MLA for the last 30, 40 years. And at the age of 79, she comes for this mechanical axis deviation of 0%. And we performed this surgery and, you know, I got it right on the table, 62%. And she started walking. She was extremely happy. She was a wonderful lady. And 3 weeks down the line, she came with complaints of pain. So what we detected was this type 2 fracture. So when they weight bear unprotectedly, they can develop a type 2 fracture, and that can lead to a slight increase. So the 71% eventual valgus that she settled in did not create any problems, fortunately. And 6 years down the line, she's really doing well. But when the patient complains of pain after surgery, you be sure that something is going wrong. And you must stop and you must take proper x-rays. And one of the x-rays to take is a 45-degree internal rotation x-ray, which really shows you what's happening at the level of the superior tibiofibular joint.
Milan, shall I disturb you for a minute? Can you go back to the earlier slide? How do you measure the 71-degree valgus? We normally measure 5-degree valgus, 10-degree valgus.
No, 71-degree mechanical axis deviation, Shiva. Mechanical axis deviation.
Okay, then it's fine.
So type 1 is lateral cortex. I'm sorry, please don't catch me. You may find a lot of mistakes. It's a Sunday morning. I've just come back from playing tennis. And it's been a long week. So do forgive
me. Even I got confused. I got confused. That's why I asked you that question.
Yeah. So 71% of the mechanical axis deviation in relation to the joint width. So, you know, when, so we're talking about type 1, we re-elaborating. You must try and go towards the lateral cortex just about opening it. And the golden screw, you go to the lateral cortex and the golden screw is going to, you know, compress this hinge. Now, what happens if you overdo the golden screw? If you overdo the golden screw, if you over tighten the golden screw, and that is where the very fine line between pre-tensioning or bending the plate or not bending the plate, because if there's a lot of curvature in the tibia and your plate is sitting quite away at the level of the osteotomy, and if you overdo it zealously, then this is going to dramatically displace, and you don't want that to happen. So you do it very gingerly. The golden screw is a very powerful tool meant to be used very, very gently, very, very sparingly, just to achieve the right amount of bending of the plate to set up the continuous compression that will happen at the hinge after surgery. So now let's come to the incision and the patellofemoral pain. So now on the left, you see the classic, you know, incision that is described by the AO people, that is from the posterior middle of the corner of the tibia to just below the tuberosity. But what we find is the other question somebody asked, I think Dr. Maheshwari, is what happens when you have patellofemoral pain? So I think we kind of solved this problem 17 years ago. And after having worked with Professor Koshino, I found that you can perform the, you know, patellar retinacular release. So whenever you have patellofemoral tenderness, you must address it. And instead of taking this oblique incision like the Europeans love to do because their patients come early, we need to take a longitudinal incision which takes care of this. And there's enough evidence in the literature. The first was the article by Christodoulou, where he only spoke about the lateral retinacular release. And the second is in this article by Koshino in 2002. He has described the lateral and medial retinacular releases in order to perform a neurectomy-like effect of the, you know, that's written up by Lee Dellen. And this has served me well. And in virtually 80% of the osteotomies from 2004, 90% of the osteotomies, I'm performing this. And the amount of pain relief is dramatic. And of course, you be very careful if the patient is on aspirin or clopidogrel, it'll bleed a lot. And you have to really make sure you perform good hemostasis. So, now let's come to one more vexing issue. That's all of us talk about ideal indications and extended indications for high tibial osteotomy. But I beg to differ. Fixed flexion deformity can also be taken care of. So this is a lady who's come to me from Gujarat. And here she is, you know, mild flexion deformity. And you can see the mechanical axis is at about 5 to 10% from the medial joint line. And so I have done the calculation. The calculation is 12%. If you draw by the Miniachi or the Dugdale method from the femoral head going down through the Fujisawa point to the virtual ankle and draw from the apex, this is 12.2. But so 12.2 degrees I found I need to open, and I open this over here. So you have to be very careful. I cannot emphasize this. So now what's going on? She's got a, I'm sorry, this is running away. But this is a very crucial slide. So patellofemoral pain, we add a release. And fixed flexion deformity of 15 degrees, so for every 5 degrees of flexion deformity, we are going to add Can I take a minute and, you know, set up this slideshow? It's using timings. I'm sorry about that. So let's come to this. Every 5 degrees of flexion deformity is hiding one more degree of varus, okay? So if you have 15 degrees of flexion deformity on a full length X-ray, then you know you need to add in 2 to 3 more degrees to the correction. Otherwise, you're going to end up with undercorrection. And there is a lateral thrust this lady has. So I have, you know, because with the external, the great advantage of the external fixation, you know, that you have, that I have used the Elizarov focal dome with an external fixator for 30 years now, exclusively for the first 18 years, is that you can correct and overcorrect till the lateral thrust is eliminated. So you can do that with an external fixator gradually, but with the plate, you have to think about this and set it up and add a degree. So eventually I corrected 15 degrees and here she is, extremely happy, single legged stance, sitting cross-legged, squatting, performing all her duties as an aunt, as a mother, as a grandmother. So, you know, sometimes you have to be very careful. Now let's come to the gray areas. You know, the opening wedge high tibial osteotomy is not, to be very honest, the last solution in osteotomies for osteoarthritis of the knee. And this lady came to me from Mumbai. She has this large varus deformity. We performed an MRI. And we also found, because we were trying to make sure, now she has a minor varus in the femur, okay, just about 4 degrees. And the question is, should we perform a closing wedge femoral osteotomy also? It's a lot of surgery and a lot of people are reluctant for 2 surgeries. I'll come to this in a moment. So here she is, you know, she's been just adequately corrected to about 62 degrees and we don't want, she had a small ACL, you know, there was a cyst at the base of the ACL in the MRI, and that was a surprising finding. And so we made sure we did not overcorrect, because when you overcorrect and when the MPTA goes beyond 95 degrees, you're going to get some degenerative changes in the ACL setting up. There's a lot of literature now. If you subscribe to the journal called KSSTA, that's Knee Surgery, Sports Medicine, Sports Traumatology and Arthroscopy, it's got hundreds of articles on opening wedge high tibial osteotomy, most of which are now slowly coming up with all the limitations. So here she is, you know. So in older people, it doesn't matter if you overcorrect a little, because they're, you know, the activity levels are not high and, you know, this they will do well. So they'll get good relief of pain despite the overcorrection. And the Tomofix plate is so forgiving for elderly people. You don't have to come back all the time for a follow-up. With the as with an external fixator, you have to really keep taking care of it. Sometimes they run into trouble. But with a plate, you have to do nothing. Now let's come to the inappropriate indications or the true limitations. Now this is a lady who was an ex-mayor of our city. She, you know, she came to me and you know, just when you're not really aware that, like Osler, one of the Oslerisms is, what the mind does not know, the eye cannot see. And what I could not see was the intra-articular deformity, which is measured by the condylar plateau angle, as we call it. It's been called by Perry Schoenecker from Washington University long ago in the treatment of Blount's as the MTPD, medial tibial plateau depression angle. And people have different names for it, but this is the, in extreme cases, it represents the pagoda tibia. So this is an intra-articular deformity. We have not overcorrected her. So she's doing well 4 years down the line. Immediately after surgery, she attended to her daughter's delivery and she could do really well. She's doing great so far. But I'm wondering how long this result will last, because this, so one of the clinical things that should make us suspect that this is not the ideal indication for an opening wedge is the mediolateral laxity or the lateral thrust while walking, which you can confirm under the C-arm like this, a big teeter-totter that opens up. So before we start congratulating ourselves that we have found the ultimate solution in high tibial osteotomy, let us be aware that our levels of ignorance are just a little beyond our levels of knowledge. So opening wedge high tibial osteotomy is good for mild varus, not for severe deformities. Okay, because why not in severe deformities? Because if you open a large wedge firstly, you're going to have difficulties in healing. You need bone grafting, you know, adds to the morbidity of the procedure. Or you take in the artificial bone substitute that Synthes sells for another 20,000 rupees, it adds to the cost. You open a large wedge, you get a hinge fracture later on, the type 2, which is very bad, or type 1, which becomes unstable, and then you have a larger deformity than you know intended. And now what the recent literature is telling us is that delta MPTA, that's a change in the MPTA more than 10 degrees, leads to ACL degeneration. I challenge all of you to look at your x-rays. I'm telling you, like the great Professor Katie Dholakia said, I'm sorry, I'm not sermonizing on a Sunday morning. I'm not at the pulpit, but Dr. Katie Dholakia said this, nothing shatters confidence like follow-up. I would add, kindly do measurements of your x-rays again and find out how many of your patients have got an MPTA of greater than 95. And then follow up these patients and let us see as real scientists, clinical scientists, what's really happening to our patients. And a wedge that is open to more than 13 millimeters will lead to patellofemoral joint problems because there is an increase in the TTTG distance. These are all, you know, recent knowledge. People are now looking at all the implications of the hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of opening wedge high tibial osteotomies everybody was doing left, right, and center, regardless of, you know, the extent of the deformity. So sometimes you can see that the patient has a femoral varus and you want to also correct him. And so you say, okay, we will start with the tibial osteotomy like this. And, you know, so you undercorrect it thinking that you're going to go down and the patient says, nah, I've got enough pain relief, I don't want. So this is one of the issues with the femoral and tibial correction, which I have found. So it started with Babis from Mayo Clinic in 2002, who said that, look, if you overcorrect, you know, the osteotomy in the tibia, you're going to get an inclination of the joint line. Okay, and then Sara Gaglia from France. So both of these gentlemen, you know, and the world is now convinced that femur and tibia is the way to go. But fortunately, Nakayama has come to our rescue and he has clearly stated that if the patient is old and his functional demands is not a sportsman, it's not necessary to perform femoral and tibial correction. So I would say in such circumstances, if you find a femoral deformity, do not overcorrect. Fujisawa is, as you know, somebody has rightly said, you have to find the magic point. It's not the Fujisawa point. And the magic point is different for every patient. All of us are different and you take into consideration. But sometimes you can get away large femoral varus and tibial varus like this. This gentleman is miserable. He can barely walk. You can see here. It's absolutely miserable. So he first started with the, you know, femoral correction like this on the x-ray on the left. We did the closing wedge osteotomy, but he was on clopidogrel and he threw a large hematoma. It took him a long time to recover. And then in the second stage, I went ahead and did, I found a mediolateral laxity. So I did the intraarticular osteotomy. You know, it's done really well. It's got a beautiful correction, just to about 55 to 60%. It's got a great function. It's walking really well. But the time interval between the two surgeries and the physiologic and the economic cost of this is very dramatically high. So in elderly folks without a very high functional demand, I would not really recommend. So again, to belabor the point about opening wedge. So we studied about 141 high tibial osteotomies over a period of 3 months. We did 13,000 measurements. And in the opening wedge, we found that the mean angle alpha we used was 11 degrees. And the mean opening, you know, base of the wedge was omega, was 11.6 mm. But in the other groups that I performed, so this is going to come as a talk the next time that is, you know, given Shiva and Dinesh's indulgence, that the focal dome osteotomies that I performed, the intraarticular osteotomies that I performed in larger varus deformities that I spoke about in the first talk, the mean, you know, for the entire group was 17 degrees, almost 18. And the mean wedge opening was 19 mm. And it went from 11 mm, it went all the way to 50 mm. How can you open a wedge that's so large without really creating lots of problems? So do not think this is the last solution. Opening wedge high tibial osteotomy is perfect for mild varus, not when there is an intraarticular deformity, if you can detect it, and not for tertiary deformities, which are present in the sagittal, axial, and rotational planes. So we are aware of the joint line convergence angle, which tells us about the intraarticular deformity. And if you overcorrect, then you're going to have in the opening wedge a large change. This P lesser than 0.05 is a large change in the knee joint line orientation, which is least affected by the intra-articular osteotomy, and a large change in the ankle joint line orientation. I've actually had patients who complained about pain in the ankle after opening wedge osteotomy, especially if you correct a large wedge. So it's least affected by the intra-articular. More about that later. So I will end now with the algorithm that I have developed, that an opening wedge high tibial osteotomy is ideal when you have a small varus, which is a primary deformity. The primary deformity, all of us are tuned to looking at x-rays. Some of us have now learned that there's no alternative to full-length x-rays. And I will digress here a little bit with your permission. Rolly Jacob, the elder statesman of high tibial osteotomy and a friend of Alex Tobley, and an elderly gentleman who passed away some time back and has thousands of high tibial osteotomies, has said, all of us must be aware that in medial compartment osteoarthritis, we have to stop relying on MRI scans. MRI scan and arthroscopy is not the gold standard which has been foisted upon us by practitioners of these sciences, because it leads us to believe that we have to do more, and more is like total knee replacement. So this is Rolly Jacob. So primary deformity is the varus. If it's a small deformity, the secondary deformity is intra-articular if it's not present. And if there are no tertiary deformities like a large flexion deformity, a large amount of rotation, and a large amount of axial deviation like shortening or lengthening, then you can perform an opening wedge. And just for your information to complete the talk, this is the entire algorithm. So the other osteotomies are the dome, which allow us to correct larger varus, the intra-articular alone, and the intra and the extra-articular. So I would like to leave you with this. It's a vast topic, but the opening wedge is a significant advantage. It started with Debeye and Hernigou in Paris in 1951. Stobley, Takeuchi, Lobenhofer, and others took it forward in the year 2000. With a wonderful Tomofix system. Now there are Arthrex, Purdue, Tomofix. Good, there's a great hardware. But the aim was early mobilization, accuracy of correction, reliability of results, and maintenance of the anatomy of the upper tibia to enable a future total knee replacement. Those were the primary aims. The Tomofix system and the opening wedge has fulfilled many of these aims. But it's not the end all and be all. In the right indications, I think it's the most wonderful surgery. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Dr. Mili, for elaborating everything in detail and limitations and some complications of open wedge high tibial osteotomy. Is there any question or from the audience or from the faculties?
Yeah, Dinesh, I would like to ask a question to Dr. Rastogi.
Yeah.
A young athlete who has got medial varus and also having arthritic changes because of that, and has got chronic ACL injury. In that patient, would you like to go for open wedge for the arthritic part? The reason is that when you go for the ACL repair, the medial plate will come in the way. And if you go for lateral closing wedge, you can avoid that implant in the way and the holes which are being made for that. So it will come in the way of the ACL reconstruction. So would you go for the open or the closed?
I think the answer is I will do open wedge and not put a screw in the hole.
There's enough literature on this subject, you know, how to, you know, keep place for the ACL reconstruction at the same time. There's
it's 12 o'clock.
No, but later if you want to do the ACL reconstruction in that patient, then will you go for ACL? Will you go for open or the closed? That's my question.
One should do open wedge. And if you are doing together, then don't put a screw in hole A. If you want to do it later, you remove the whole A screw and do the ACL repair. And many patients probably would also not require a ACL surgery by slope correction if they are not in very active sports.
They're young patients, young athlete who has got the multi-ligament.
Open wedge slope correction, leave the whole A. Don't put a screw there.
Will it serve the purpose?
Pardon me?
Will it serve the purpose?
It always. And this is the way to go about it. I would not say always.
Because the trajectory will not fall. Because the requirement of the fixation of the plate will be little here and there, which will not...
No, the plate has to be put posteriorly, like Dr. Mangal also said, he puts a spin posteriorly because the tibia width is more. So if you put the plate posteriorly and don't put a screw in hole A, then it is fine. If you're going to do together, if you want to
not together.
You remove the you. If it is healed, you can remove the implant. If it is not healed, you can remove the screw from hole A.
Okay.
And what is your threshold for the threshold of the varus you go for surgery of the open wedge osteotomy? Which are the patients where minimum this much varus should be there? Then what is your lowest range of varus you have corrected?
It depends if the patient is ready or not. If he has pain, if he is willing for surgery, fine. I usually start treating these patients with lifestyle modification, exercise and weight control very extensively. So in the process, I lose some of the cases which could be operated immediately. But I have patients who have conserved their knee without surgery for 10 years, 15 years. They still have a varus. But minimum varus, it is symptomatic. Patient wants relief, it could be done early also. That means 15 mm from the center of the knee joint.
I would like to talk about this distance from the center of the knee joint as a method of, you know, determining the varus. I take great umbrage with it. It's something that Dror Pilli started writing about 30 years ago. We should always measure in percentage of the joint width, not in millimeters. Because if somebody has got a large knee, 90 millimeters width, 15 millimeters distance from the center is not the same as somebody who has a...
I agree on that.
Is there any provision to take a question from audience? I don't know if the system is allowing the questions from the audience or not.
YouTube, there's no questions at least. I don't know.
I would like to talk about this issue of lengthening caused by opening wedge high tibial osteotomy very briefly. Do not take it lightly. Sometimes the amount of lengthening is 7 to 8 millimeters or even more. And if you do not recognize it and do not take a special X-ray, you can calculate it at the center of the wedge, but you need to take a special X-ray later on. And what happens if you do not compensate this with a wedge, do not make it a point to tell the patient, they do not compensate it. And then the way they compensate it is by going into flexion in the operated side. And when the operated side goes into flexion, then their symptoms come back. So they really become miserable. And many of our patients come back after high tibial osteotomy after some problem or the other. And this is one of the problems which you have to recognize. And it can be disconcerting. And you have to take this into consideration, especially when you're thinking about correcting a large varus. And they go back into flexion deformity. Go look at your patients carefully. They're developing an FFD on the operated side after the surgery. These are the possible reasons. And there may be some others also.
So what you're suggesting is we must give a ring on the other side.
Yes, simple solution. Simple solution.
For the period, they don't get that operated or
opposite. Sir.
Yes.
Most of the times, Dr. Milin, your post-operative X-rays were showing that weight bearing axis passing through the center of the knee. In few patients, in few who wants to remain physically very active, you prefer to pass a weight bearing axis through the center, right?
Not overcorrect. I would change the, can you still hear me?
Yeah.
I would, you know, we've over, it's 32 years now that I'm performing a high tibial osteotomy. And, you know, it's a very big subject. In some people who don't have a very high demand, they have a lateral thrust. You need to overcorrect until the lateral thrust is eliminated. Because if you measure, say, if you want to go up to the Fujisawa point, and you go up to the Fujisawa point, 62% of the joint width, and the patient still has a lateral thrust. And if you believe in the work of Tom Andriachi, they have pain, and I have seen this. So you need to overcorrect some people. But some people who really have a high demand, like the orthopedic surgeon I did who wants to run such a lot, if you go even up to the Fujisawa point, he's going to be in trouble because valgus is not well tolerated by athletes. And so I barely corrected him to 54. That's one part of the answer. And the second part of the answer is part of this bubble that we live in of our great knowledge about high tibial osteotomy, is that alignment is not the only king. If we think alignment is the king, then the king or the emperor is, he's wearing his new clothes. But there's a lot of things we still don't know. And alignment is not the only predictor of long-term pain results. We'll come to that later. So yes, short answer, very active patients don't overcorrect too much.
One question to Milind. Milind, which case you will advise uni rather than SQ?
Sir, you are asking me?
Yes.
Milind, I'm never advise uni. Never. And never.
You never.
Reason. I found no reason to advise a uni.
There are second school of thought which has come up that, you know, the osteotomy, uni is better than osteotomy. And that school is propaganding this kind of uni replacement. And there should be a boundary. Beyond that, the osteotomy is not possible. Only uni is possible.
Sir, it's a matter of philosophy. And I guess those who are very good at uni or total knee replacement will give a great result. And I have no objection with that. It takes all sorts, and we cannot claim to have the final solution on all knee arthritis problems. There will always be uni, there will always be total knee, and there will be high tibial osteotomy, which is going to increase over a period of time. It depends on you. With whatever faith and dedication and great concentration, you will do your surgeries. I think you will get an equally good result with a very well-performed high tibial osteotomy. Dr. Koshino has shown, now coming to the evidence, bone on bone also will give good result in the long term. Roly Jakob has said that people who have bone on bone to start with can end up with 135 degrees range of motion after many years. And people with, you know, unis or total knees, 25 to 33% are very unhappy. And you know the thing about unicondylar, now they are saying that unless and until you are performing a large number of unis, you will not have good results. So it's a kind of self-fulfilling prophecy. So personally, I don't think any of my patients really need a uni.
Suppose a patient is a senior citizen, say more than 75 or 80 years old, and have a simple medial compartment osteoarthritis. He don't want to remain very physically active. So particularly in that case, either total knee or uni, do you recommend, or that patients also you are choosing high tibial osteotomy?
Medial opening wedge with a Tomofix.
Even age is more than 75, 80.
Age is not a contraindication.
I understand, but they don't have much high demand also.
So that doesn't mean you take away their knee.
No, that's all. That's good.
No. It is clear. And you see, the main problem is the rehab program has also not been properly understood with Tomofix.
That's okay. But the practical issues, what happening?
Issues are that we have to understand, like Dr. Milind said, what is right and what we believe and what the science tells us.
No, that's all.
Otherwise, people are getting their knee joints replaced at the age of 40, 35, 45.
It should not be there. I understand. Yes. But one issue is I will compare with fractured neck femur, where we know that there is a chances of avascular necrosis later on. So after 65, we usually do bipolar or something like hemi replacement. So the same way, why we are doing bipolar or hemi replacement? The reason is that we don't want a second surgery, right? The same way, can we think that 80-year-old or a 75-year-old man who wants to go back to that routine activities earlier, because we have to agree that after high TB osteotomy, we may have to give some crutches or some walker.
For a period of 4 to 6 weeks.
4 to 6 weeks, but in the after replacing the knee, either unicondylar or total knee replacement, I have observed that they are back to normal if it is done proper and it
affects. It is only 60%. Otherwise, they continue their rehab program for 6 months and more.
Yes.
The way I always think is there is white and black, and there are gray areas, which is a large area. So it depends on what you want to see.
Yes, what?
It is as simple as that.
Dr. Shiv Shankar was
there. Yes, no. Shall I share a case so that I want to what you people will do?
Yeah,
this
yeah,
is sir. A age is not seen. Yeah, 61-year lady. Sanjay, what you will do? Then next question will be same to Dr. Mangal Parihar, then to Milind.
Milind would answer this question best.
Okay. Directly shifted the buck to Milind.
Yes. Because there's a subluxation of the joint, and which requires, the way I understand, a TCVO. But since I'm not very, very comfortable with the procedure, I would not suggest something. If patient wants to conserve, then he should consult an expert. If he wants to get his knee replaced, he can go anywhere.
On the left side, you can see that there isn't too much of a femoral varus. There is a varus in the metaphysis of the tibia, and there is a small amount of, you know, condylar mismatch, but there is a large JLC. So this is the kind of patient who, with a very large mechanical axis deviation, I think will do well with a combined intra and extra articular osteotomy of the tibia. If the patient has the physiological and economic wherewithal to go for both femur and tibia surgery, you could add a small closing wedge in the femur, but this femur doesn't look like it's in a lot of varus. So yes, I would do an intra plus extra articular now, which we have learned to do with a single plate.
Yes.
The tibia.
Okay. Mangal, you want to add anything?
Similar. I can't make out on this whether there is a condylar depression, but probably a DFO and a HTO would be kind of the minimum. Then depending on what the stress x-ray shows, if there is that plateau, you know, depression there, that also may need to be elevated.
Okay. Anyway, what I did, I'll tell. So that was the time I was not doing, knowing also about PCVO or all these newer things. So I just did the fixator assisted. The patient only got it done on the left side. You can see that since the patient was elderly, I did some accordion technique. I just compressed and distracted. So that's why you get that new bone in that part. And she came back to me after fixator removal only after 6 years. This is in 2019. She is extremely happy. She is able to squat with that, but right side is totally gone. Now there was no point for me to wait and do anything. So I replaced that knee on the right side. So she is able to stand single leg. You can see on the side, HTO was done. So right side, you can see there is a collapse of the medial condyle. I had to graft it and put a screw and get the instrument. Now she is able to stand on single side, both the sides. So just wanted to share this.
She probably prefers the left side.
I don't know. I don't know, because I didn't meet her personally. Because of lockdown, she has sent these pictures. The son took the pictures. I just sent few pictures how to take and send it. So these X-ray pictures have been sent. on WhatsApp. Yeah.
One thing I want to comment on the first X-ray, sir.
Yes.
The X-ray was weight-bearing X-ray. The first X-ray.
Yeah, correct.
Many times I have observed that, most of the time I do preoperative calculation only on non-weight-bearing full-length X-ray, non-weight-bearing, in lying-down position. I take always lying-down position, because if we take in a lying-down position, the varus is that the JLCA will be reduced. Here JLCA, there is a large JLCA. So it will reduce, and most of the time the correction required is much less, as we see in the weight-bearing X-ray. I can show the cases also, but at present,
it may not be possible. Next time, you are right.
But yes. we do the same thing.
Yeah.
On the full length X-ray, we subtract the JLC.
That is another option. Inherent JLCA. Suppose on non-weight-bearing also, there is some 1 or 2 degree of JLCA.
It is common
that we may have to compensate while doing a correction.
But it is not a gross difference between the lying down and standing. Standing will be definitely more, but lying down 1 or 2 degree, not more.
No. In particular, this will find no
GLCA.
I take a single leg stance standing. The patient will be flexing the opposite knee, and the leg will be kept on a stool. So it's a single leg standing. So definitely, as Dinesh has said, it will be much more.
I
think, but sir, one thing observed is that if the alignment is done in a case where the lateral compartment is good, if you have done the procedure right, patients are reasonably happy in long term in after fistula. This is the tech.
That's we have observed. Now should we turn to the next talk? And open versus closed wedge height velocity. Nothing much to say about this, but still I have prepared few slides, so it will not take a long time. So first I will share the screen. Can you see everyone?
Yes.
Sorry. Now we all know that in 20th century up to 1990, the closed wedge height velocityotomy was more popular, and about 3 decades was there to perform the closed wedge osteotomy, particularly Coventry osteotomy. Classical Coventry osteotomy was a closed wedge valgization osteotomy, which was done above the tibial tuberosity and with or without fibular osteotomy. It was widely used for a long time, but it loses its importance. It was described in 1965, where the telephone instruments was like this, and we are using routinely this type of car. But at that time, particularly, HTO became a milestone in the management of osteoarthritis knee, and became and remained popular till today probably. But today the technique has been changed. So still today, I have written till today because here one of the panelists, Dr. Maheshwari, is still doing Coventry osteotomy with excellent outcome. For most of the surgeons, it lost importance in 1990s, probably due to the some genuine issues of unpredictable results. And at that time, particularly, more predictable total knee replacement came into the picture. And gradually, it becomes a cup of tea for a very few orthopedic surgeons and made a HTO a forgotten art for most of the orthopedic surgeons. So era of total knee replacement started from 1985 to the probably till today also, we can consider that it's an era of total knee replacement, because high tibial osteotomy surgeons are very few as compared to replacement surgeons. Why total knee become more popular? Probably it become more popular due to some predictable reasons as compared to Coventry. I'm not talking about the modern osteotomies of open wedge and TCVO or closed wedge, which I do. But if we compare with the tomofix, then it become more predictable. And another thing, it gives a total knee replacement, gives some instant results. As I said, here in Ahmedabad, on the next day, patient is walking with a walker with a full weight bearing, and they climb stairs on the third day. And almost at the end of 15 days, they are walking without supports in Ahmedabad, particularly. More and more surgeons have become...
Even in Cholapur, they walk after third day, not only in Ahmedabad.
Yeah, I don't know. Right, you may be right. And probably it gives instant relief, instant results. That may be the reason. And another thing, before a few years, it has easy way to earn money for the surgeons and for the companies also. And there was a lot of industrial support to commercialize it, to market it, and to put inside the brain of our patients. Industries were very helpful to put the ideas of total knee replacement in the, not only in the minds of surgeons, but in the minds of patients also. So on that particular background, total knee replacement overcome the high debil osteotomy. So, but now from year 2000, as Dr. Milin said, year 2000, Dr. Stobley and Longenheffer and others have took a lot of efforts to make the opening wedge in a perfect manner. And at that time, particularly, we evolved with the digital X-rays so that we can take a full length X-rays and we can calculate exactly how much deformity, where the deformity is, and how much we have to correct it. So, and they have designed a very, very reliable and very strong plate, that is Tomofix, and other Kudu plates and all other implants has came into the picture, but Tomofix becomes more popular as compared to other implants. So opening wedge osteotomy was becoming more and more popular in 21st century, in the beginning of 21st century and till today. Now, any surgeon who is performing the high debil osteotomy, most of them are open wedges. Now, closed wedges are very few. Probably very, very few surgeons are doing closed wedge at present. So why open wedge become more popular in the current years? Because it restores the normal anatomy of the proximal tibia. It's a faster and easier surgery as compared to closed wedge. It's fixed with the implants, so there is no plaster is needed, and fibula doesn't require any intervention. There is a ligament laxity. If there is a ACL, PCL, we can be compensated by altering the slope, and probably future knee replacement is easy if required in any few of the patients. So that were the reasons it became popular as compared to closed wedge. If we see the advantage and disadvantage of open and closed wedge, the closed wedge is a longer surgery because it now, if we compare a Coventry, then we have to remove the wedge above the tibial tubercle, and then we have to do some intervention to the fibula. While open wedge, if we don't do a biplanar, probably biplanar could take a long time, but if we cut at the above the tibial tuberosity and in an oblique manner, and if we open, it's only one cut in the tibia will require in open wedge. So it's a faster surgery. In closed wedge, advantage is there is no bone graft is necessary because proximal and distal fragment is in contact with each other. While in open wedge, sometimes it may be necessary to put a bone graft or some other substitute if high correction is required. In closed wedge, it's difficult to take a precision whether we have corrected it perfectly or not. While in open wedge, it's a higher precision rate. We can exactly calculate how much degree we have opened. In closed wedge, after closing, how much we have closed, effectively how much we have closed, that is very difficult in closed wedge. And there was a risk of peroneus nerve lesion in after closed wedge, and there is a risk of saphenous nerve is not very important now, but risk of saphenous nerve injury after open wedge. As I already said, fibula requires some intervention in closed wedge. Either we do Coventry or if we do infratuberosity closed wedge osteotomy, then fibula will require some intervention. While no treatment of fibula is necessary, in open wedge. So these are some advantages and disadvantages, but we have to accept the one thing, what I have also observed by doing so many open wedge, around 40 to 50 open wedge high degree osteotomy, and close wedge I do it very regularly. I must have performed more than 500 close wedge high tibial osteotomies. Is my routine practice to do close wedge osteotomy, but not Coventry osteotomy that we will discuss in the next talk. So faster union in close wedge as compared to open wedge, as both fragments are in very much contact and are compressed with each other. So it unites very fast. To my experience, at the end of about 5 to 6 weeks, patient can bear full weight bearing. After 6 to 8 weeks, they are without support and walking comfortably. And after 3 months, they can even sit on the floor, either sitting cross-leg or squatting. So this is the biggest advantage of close wedge, that it provides a faster union. While open wedge will take a longer, probably longer time, because if you put a bone graft also, then also it has to be replaced by creeping substitution to have a new bone formation in that particular area. And about, as literature says, about 12 to 16 weeks is required for the complete union of the open wedge. So if we suppose think about the indications, close wedge, if patella baja, the close wedge is better above the tibial tubercle, and open wedge, if there is a patella alta, then open wedge can increase the distance between tip of the inferior pole of patella to the tibial tuberosity. If there is an intact medial collateral ligament, we can perform or tight medial collateral ligament. We have to do close wedge, because open wedge can even further tighten and increase the pressure in the medial compartment. And open wedge, if there is a laxity of medial collateral ligament, open wedge can take care of by opening, because what we are erasing the superficial part of medial collateral ligament, deep part of the medial collateral ligament always tightens after open wedge high tibial osteotomy. Nowadays, very much less arthrotomy is performed. But if we want to do simultaneous lateral arthrotomy, close wedge is better. And if you want to do medial arthrotomy, then open wedge is better. Contraindication: patella alta is contraindication for close wedge. And if there is associated anterior cruciate ligament reconstruction, as Dr. Maheshwari has asked to Dr. Rastogi, and I have performed few open wedge high tibial osteotomy along with anterior cruciate ligament reconstruction. As he said, in hole A, we cannot put, we have to omit to putting screw in hole A. What we were doing shorter locking bolts, which was reaching up to the tunnel, which was made by the arthroscopist to do a anterior cruciate ligament reconstruction. So in close wedge, probably it may be not possible to do anterior cruciate ligament reconstruction along with high tibial osteotomy, while we can perform open wedge with anterior cruciate ligament reconstruction. If correction is more than 15 degree, it becomes difficult for open wedge to correct, and it takes an even longer time to unite. As Dr. Rastogi said, up to 22 degree, they can easily perform without any interpositional bone graft or something like that. But still, it take a longer time if we open more than 15 degree. And if there is pre-existing patellofemoral arthritis, obviously we should avoid the open wedge above the tibial tuberosity. Probably pre-existing mild patellofemoral arthritis, probably we can do fixator assisted, as Mangal Pariyar is doing at just below the tibial tubercle, and is not altering anything in the patellofemoral joint. So if we review the literature, there is average increase in the length was 5.5 millimeter after open wedge osteotomy, and average decrease, there is some decrease in the limb length after close wedge. Obviously, it depends on how much wedge we are removing and how much wedge we are opening. So it was average 2.7 millimeter after close wedge, and there was no change in the stability of implant in lateral closing or medial opening wedge if fixed with the Tomofix. So fixation stability of opening versus closing wedge after high tibial osteotomy was equal if we fix it with the Tomofix. The effect of close and open wedge high tibial osteotomy on tibial slope. There is a tendency to decrease posterior tibial slope after closed wedge. And there is a tendency to increase that after open wedge if we are not careful. If we are careful while doing closed wedge, we can always maintain the posterior tibial slope. But some human error occurs in both the cases. In open wedge, there is a tendency, if we study randomly, then there is some increase in the posterior tibial slope after open wedge, and there is a decrease in the posterior tibial slope after closed wedge because of the geometry of proximal tibia. So if we compare the complications after closing and opening wedge, there is obviously wound infection. I don't think it makes any difference in closing or opening wedge, but there is, in that particular study, it was in one case out of 45, and in closing wedge there was no infection. Non-union rate, as we think logically, obviously it must be more in opening wedge. In this particular study, there were two patients there was a non-union, and there was a common peroneal nerve palsy in one patient, and there was some bone iliac crest morbidity because bone graft may require if you want to open more than 15 degree, and the reoperation rate was also a bit higher in opening wedge as compared to closed wedge. So there are some literature reviews of open and closed wedge. So open wedge has limitations already said by Dr. Milind Chaudhary. Like if there is a flexion deformity of more than 10 degree or varus more than 12 degree, may not be possible. Valgus knee probably is difficult by open wedge because lateral open wedge has not been described. And if there is an internal tibial torsion like this, if we see here, there is internal tibial torsion, probably it may not be possible to correct with the open wedge. So these are all limitations of open wedge, and infratuberosity closed wedge osteotomy, which I usually perform, can solve these issues in most of the cases. If you perform at the level of tibial tubercle and apex in the metaphysis and base in the diaphysis, and if we fix it with the plate and screws, so if we can correct it largely, it can, as there is a very much good contact between two fragments, it unites faster, and probably post-operatively patient may become more comfortable as compared to open wedge. So these are the issues of not taking much time of all. Thanks for your kind attention. Thank you. Anything else we want to discuss, sir?
You can stop sharing the screen.
Okay. Where I can, I don't know.
Dinesh bhai, which method you have adopted for measuring the wedge?
Usually I do, I take a full length x-ray both in weight bearing and non-weight bearing in lying down position. I take usually lying down position also, but the calculation I do in the non-weight bearing, that is in lying down position, because many times I have observed that there is some opening in the lateral joint space and some collapse in the medial joint space. So it gives, in initial I was calculating on weight bearing x-rays, so it leads to overcorrection, because as after closing wedge we don't have much chance to change it now. So usually perfect calculation and perfect execution is very important in closed wedge, particularly which I do. So in that particularly I measure in non-weight bearing full length x-ray, and then I execute the surgery.
Do you do surgery on both the sides, median and lateral? You have seen the x-rays.
Pardon?
You do surgery on both the sides, the median and lateral, both the sides, you put the implants?
Yeah, on lateral side, I put two screws and tension bend wiring on the lateral side. first, and then I fix as a stabilization plate on the medial side. That is with midline incision. Probably we will discuss much detail in the next webinar, because I am going to show the video and explain in detail about closed wedge, which I perform. And you are also showing on the Coventry osteotomy how you perform it.
So I think you must be complimented, Dr. Maheshwari, and yourself. You still are the exponents of closing wedge osteotomy, which definitely requires a little more accuracy. With opening wedge, there is only one cut. Closing wedge, you have to do two cuts very accurately.
Not only two cuts, we have to cut the fibula also.
Correct.
That is also. But I stick to the closed wedge, the reason only that at present, since last 3 years with a fixation of original Tomofix plate, not Indian made Tomofix, original Tomofix, I allow them to bear weight on the next day. So most of the patients are bearing weight more than 50% till they don't have any pain. And at the end of, I think, 4 to 6 weeks, they have full weight bearing. And after 6 weeks, very few patients require stick, additional stick to walk. So what I believe that, and I have observed, and I have taken some opinions from my patients, those who have undergone total knee replacement, even after consulting me and have done some counseling about the high debilitating osteotomy, they have undergone total knee replacement. So they were very close to me, and I asked them why this was happened. Because they were not ready to accept this walker for 6 weeks, and they wanted to go back. And some of the patients are going very early back to work after total knee replacement. So I was trying to make high debilitating osteotomy more comfortable for the patients, rather than to have them academic interest. No doubt I like open wedge more than closed wedge. But only reason I stuck, and another thing, I must have done 40 to 50 open wedge high debilitating osteotomies in about few years back. And very few patients turn for the opposite side for open wedge. If I remember, only 3 patients came for their opposite side after 3-4 years. And almost all the patients, most of the patients, those who have undergone closed wedge, which I perform on the one side, most of them are not preferring total knee replacement on opposite side. That is a differentiating criteria why I stick to the closed wedge.
Complication rates are reasonably less when you do closed wedge.
Probably union is faster. That may be the reason. Patient becomes symptoms free earlier as compared to open wedge. That I have observed in my patients only. That is the reason. Because after doing so many osteotomies, if you see the post-operative X-ray, it will be very hard to find where the osteotomy is done. It looks like a normal tibia. That angle has been corrected. So it takes very much less time to unite. That is what I have observed.
Yeah, if I may comment about weight bearing, the difference you are saying is between closing and opening wedge. But I think it's got to do with the body weight and the body mass index of the patient.
Yeah.
So in thin, lean patients with a Tomofix, we can allow early weight bearing. You know, because you talk about convincing people about HTO rather than TKR, I want to tell you that the ability to bear weight early is a function of their body mass index. And if you have thin, lean patients, you should not worry whether you are doing a closing wedge or an opening wedge. They're going to walk very fast. They're going to get back to work. I have doctors who come into my clinic 4 weeks after they come and they sit cross-legged in front of me on the floor. They're not using a walker. So
after high tibial osteotomy?
Yeah, after opening wedge high tibial osteotomy with a Tomofix plate. If they're not too heavy, the BMI is not more than 35. So don't worry about it. You know, you are the person who can convince and put it into nice words. There is no delay.
Yeah, I understand. But the whole gap, does it take a little time to fill with
I think the block is in the understanding of the situation. The bone on the lateral and the anterior side is already in contact. The way I have understood is the MRI shows union from day 6 or beyond. At 3 weeks, there is bone formation, and on the medial side, there's a plate. So there should not be any hesitation in allowing weight bearing
Of course, it depends how mobile that patient was. And I Dr. Milind says, what is his BMI? Every patient is not the same, but patient who is ambulatory could be made ambulatory much faster.
I agree with Sanjay. There is really no need to go slow on weight bearing if they have in control and they have good quadriceps function.
Yes. So that the way it is said, functional rehabilitation.
Yes.
If they don't stop them, they should be just careful. And we must start the muscle training and the gait training at 3 to 4 or 6 weeks and they'll be fine.
Yeah. So really,
you know, we have to have the confidence that an open wedge osteotomy with a tomofix is a stable construct.
It's a very stable construct.
Yeah. The block is probably in our understanding that it is not stable.
Absolutely. The key is what's happening at the lateral hinge.
Yes.
You've got a nice hinge which you have compressed very well with a golden screw and there is no displacement of the hinge.
Yes.
The distal fragment has not gone laterally or medially by overdoing it or underdoing it. And, you know, it's not a very large wedge. That's an extremely stable construct. And then it depends upon quadriceps function. Because what happens if you're going to open a large... See, the worry is patients who have got a less height and you're opening a large wedge. These are the patients in whom you end up with some difficulties, I've found. The quadriceps goes into inhibition. There's a patella baja element. And there's an instability because of the large wedge that's created. And if the quadriceps goes into inhibition, so like Sanjay said, you have to individualize. And it's about, you know, if they have got good quadriceps function and they're good control over the knee, you should not think that this is going to wait until the bone heals. You cannot, no, this is not correct. They walk very early,
I have
seen. The other thing is, preoperative exercise program, preoperative counseling.
Yes.
This is also very important. I think I teach them the muscle training program before even I advise them surgery.
Great. I agree.
After how many days you allow climbing stairs after open wedge?
ASAP. ASAP with crutches initially.
Because there are some issues because people want to go to the office or they want to cook some food for them in the kitchen because there are nuclear families now. There is no joint families. So all these issues come into the picture while doing high debile osteotomy because everyone wants to be independent very early. And they have to climb some one or two steps. Some people might have a step in while to go into the toilet.
Dr. Dinesh, that's the great advantage of the opening wedge and the tomofix system.
Yeah, that's the...
The mobilization in its various avatars is the biggest advantage of the opening wedge with the tomofix system.
Yeah, but I took advantage of both. The closing advantage of close wedge and tomofix both, because tomofix is a very stable construct and close wedge probably.
I agree.
I took advantage of both at least.
Good. I agree with you. Very true.
Milind, if this topic is over, I have one more question. Any literature available about the height? If the patient height is less, then in that case, it's very difficult to have a bigger wedge.
Sir, we in the lockdown last year, we did a lot of work and we were trying to find out a calculation about the original femur and tibia length in relation to the wedge also. I think there will be some, you know, there will be some literature about this, but this is from my anecdotal experience. The short people who have a large varus, we have to be very careful in, you know, opening a very large wedge. I think
it's very difficult, because we don't get any tibia proximal.
You are right.
Another thing, Dr. Maheshwari, if a patient is of short stature, suppose there is a fixed varus of 5 degree or 6 degree or 7 degree. 7 degree varus with a short stature will require more opening or more close wedge removal. And if the same amount of deformity, suppose 7 degree in a short stature and 7 degree in a long, very long, tall person, the opening will require less in taller person as compared to short stature, because I have calculated in so many patients, and many times I surprise why there is more removal of wedge in short stature, because it shifts, weight bearing axis very much less in short stature patient. That is in software calculation only. That is what I observed.
I think these are the data, you know, which should come up now, because there are so many gray areas in the osteotomy side, and what available is, because the study has started now. Otherwise, if you talk about the TKI, there are a lot of studies and a lot of material available regarding high level osteotomy. Material is comparatively less, and the experience also less.
You want to be swamped with information? Open KSSTA. Now there are hundreds and hundreds of articles. So be sure you will. It will come out of your ears and nose and mouth. There's so much literature. It can get confusing if you don't have the right perspective, because there's so much literature on open wedge high tibial osteotomy. You'll be amazed the aspects that they have studied. What happens to rotation? What happens to the slope? What happens when? So, for example, you know, the size of the wedge, Dinesh, is related to the size of the tibia.
Yeah, that's also one true.
1 millimeter is equal to 1 degree. This is the big thing about closing wedge. It's true if the tibia width is 57 millimeters.
Yeah, that I know.
Okay. So, you know, so this...
We cannot rely on that. 1 degree is equal to 1 millimeter. We cannot rely on that.
So there's too much literature, sir. On opening wedge, though, there is too much literature. Quite honestly, so much so that it is becoming, you know, as though there is no other, it's not... There is a hell of a...
I agree.
You know, what they call this, cutting jigs for opening wedge. I think that's complete nonsense, if you ask me. It's complete nonsense.
You know, even the imaging has come in the theater. Computer-assisted surgery.
Yes. Navigation is there. Then, you know, now they'll come up with robotic open. I think these are not so important. Because really, you over a period... Sir, I agree, and I admit to all of you that, you know, for vast majority of our older patients who have got less functional demands, an opening wedge or closing wedge, whether you overcorrect a little bit or, if you undercorrect but with a stable implant, it doesn't matter. If you overcorrect a little bit, it doesn't matter in the patients who don't have a very high demand. So we are quite safe. So it's a bit of nitpicking about, you know, all the aspects about opening wedge. So closing wedge, opening wedge, you do it well with a good stable implant which maintains the correction, they'll do well, vast majority.
Agreed.
I think we are 50 minutes overshooted. So should we leave the meeting now?
Yes, sir. Thank you all very much. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you, sir. Thanks to all speakers. Thank you.
Thank you
very much.